Though our tanks and artillery are mighty, it is the vast ranks of the Imperial Guardsmen that shall trample the enemy to dust. Let them come. 3D printer's not working. Fine. I'll use Games Workshop models. God knows I've got enough. Now, which ones do we need? Ooh, what is going on, guys? Welcome back. And there's a lot of plastic here. What have I done? And that really is a question that I will be answering in this video. What have I done here? So with this one, I'm going to do it a little bit different. Normally, I've been talking about the lore, about one of the factions within the video. But I feel like this one's going to need a bit of a different angle. I've built this in sort of anticipation of 10th edition coming out. And we'll get a bit more into that later and talk about why. But I want to sort of go through how I make my dioramas as well. I don't really do that with you guys. So here's a video which is going to have a little bit more build instruction and lighting instruction. And a little bit less on the lore and more on what I'm anticipating is going to be coming with 10th edition. So let's crack on. And by looking at what I'm doing here, I seem to be marking out how I want my diorama to start. So I put MT down for mortar teams because I know I want some mortars on this. I'm not sure what I want their support weapon to be for their mortar pits. So I was thinking maybe heavy bolter or a heavy las cannon, something along those lines, a little bit of entrenchment. And I want the switch for the lights that I'm going to be using to be on the top instead of hidden away under the bottom. So you don't have to disturb the piece when it comes to actually turning it on and off. Now, as well, what I'm trying to bear in mind whilst doing this is I want to give a real sense of urgency, a real tidal wave of Tyranids, because I've done Tyranids before. We've all seen me do it. And I wasn't sure if I was going to put anything in the middle or what I was going to do with the middle stretch. So I wasn't sure whether I was going to have like a downed space marine who, you know, maybe have some Elysian drop troops come in and they were going to sort of try and save it. I suddenly thought there's getting too much onto this piece. Too many stories in too tight of a space. Eventually, I did end up removing that and just replacing it with something a lot more simplistic, but yet still just as impactful, which you will see later on in the video. Again, you may have seen a little bit in the intro with the two guys running up the field. But as you'll already be able to tell, there's definitely been some changes in the way that I have actually structured and made this model from the start of the process to the end. And with these Tyranids, as I was saying, I really want a real tidal wave. So I did use, there's about, I think 68, 69-ish Tyranids on this small space in this diorama, because I never felt like I ever used enough Tyranids. So to really give them that real heavy feel of, oh God, what is that weird clicky, buggy, slimy thing rushing towards me with lots of nasty gnashing teeth? It's the Tyranids. So as previously stated, I really wanted to get the power source underneath, but the actual switch on top. And for that, I've grabbed one of these battery power packs. And what I have done is I've just drilled a hole into the power button, and then I've inserted a tiny steel rod into it, glued it on, and that's going to give it the length to poke up through the base of the model for me to attach something to it to use as the button or switch for it later on. So a bit of pre-planning on that definitely goes a long way. Then, as I've done before, I've just measured out where I wanted this to sit on the board, added a bit of paint, given it a dot, and then dremeled out the hole for it to slide through and made sure that it can slide freely at this point with a little bit more give, as you might get sort of paint and things in there later which could constrict it. So make it a little bit bigger now, because there's a chance you're going to accidentally fill in the hole with, you know, whatever, just a bit gunk later on. So just pre-plan for that and you should be absolutely golden. And now we have more than a few packs of Tyranids to assemble. This isn't going to take forever at all. Well, that was horrendous. But I've got all my Tyranids now assembled. And, you know, I can just put the fact of the thought of painting these to the very back of my mind for now. So the next step is going to be wiring up our las cannon. As I went against having the heavy bolter in aid of having the las cannon, because I found some 30 centimeter 3-volt flexible filament in red. I thought that is going to look pretty damn cool as a laser being fired out of the las cannon. So what I had done here was I drilled out the barrel all the way into the main compartment of the model there and added a bit of copper wire, which I've then hit with a lighter and then a bit of sandpaper to remove the outer sheeting so that I can solder on to the end of our filament without it sort of having a bad connection. So it basically makes up for my crummy soldering abilities with well, it just covers up for that. It just means that I don't have to be too spot on, and it doesn't really affect the overall current flow of the lights. So as 10th edition is about to launch, we're about to get a whole ton of new lore to go with it, which is going to obviously progress the storyline of the 40k universe. Where are we at the moment? Well, as this video stands, what has happened is we've just had the lion, who has just woken up from his slumber. I know, lazy bones. Quick 10,000 year nap, why not? You got Rabuta Gulliman, who is still leading the Indominus Crusade, and a lot of the Imperium's resources are now tied up in what they are up to. Angron has just destroyed a fleet of the Indominus Crusade. Vashnor, a demigod of the Chaos Guards, has teamed up with Amadon and they're off looking for a key or something like that. And the Tyranids have just turned up in Segmentum Pacificus, which is right next to Segmentum Solar, where the throne world, where Terra is. And it is now a vast scramble to get the bureaucracy of the Imperium moving a little bit quicker in order to put out that tidal wave, which is what I've gone with in this diorama build. Nice big wave of Tyranids. There are new species of Tyranids which we haven't encountered before, so there's gonna be lots of new model ranges coming out, which is gonna be nice for you Tyranid players. And also we've got more Space Marines, we've got Terminators coming up. I can't wait to get my hands on some of those new Terminators because I'm a Grey Knights player, so that's gonna be nice to add them to my Grey Knight army. But in total we have just a few pockets of resistance from the Astra Militarum, which are combating the Tyranids at the moment, and a few QRF, rapid response, from the Space Marines. We've got some Ultramarines, and because the threat is that imposing, we have Custodes who have landed and are now fighting the Tyranids. So that leaves us open for a lot of lore, some pretty cool dioramas that we can be able to come up with. I'm gonna try not make it all too Tyranid based. I might do some chaosy stuff soon. I've got a few ideas, ideas I wanna try in some smaller pieces, just to make sure that I understand the techniques behind some things before we go ahead and make a big piece. So that's where we are. That's where we have landed at the moment. Let's carry on with this build, and we might talk a little bit more about the lore soon. So I knew that the big challenge here was going to be painting all of these Tyranids, an absolute behemoth of a task. So I tried to cut corners, but without sort of losing anything in the long run. I knew that they were going to be all amassed at the end, so any imperfections would be hidden. So I did an all-over dry brush of Celestra Grey and then Corax White for the bodies. And then I did choose three purples. I only ended up using two of them. So I used Nagahoff Knight and Gene Stealer Purple. Those were the Citadel colours that I used whilst painting this. I then went on to do a little bit with the Scyvan Talons and some of the claws and weapons. I used a base coat of Burnt Red from Vallejo Game Color, which I absolutely love this color, and Deep Red as the highlight color from AK Interactive. And then I even went on and tried to get their teeth done. Don't know why I did that. Totally weird, took way too long, but wasn't that much of a task. So I used just Tan Earth from Vallejo, and then I used panel liner for the teeth just to really bring out and show any sort of gaps that I had sort of filled in with any paint, that it would then just sort of give them that bit more of a menacing look having the teeth done. I did like the effect in the end, I just sort of don't really understood why I decided to do it.
Wow. It's not like I've got a whole bucket. Oh, this is taking so long. I chose to do this. This is all on me. These are all terrible life decisions.
So going back to our diorama, we've got everything painted up. It's time to start getting the board put together and making it look like a piece of terrain. After we've done that, we can finish off our lighting, and then we're almost finished with this piece. Now, the thing that I like to do with my ground forming, you may have noticed before, but I haven't really gone into much detail on, is I like to do it with a lot of washes. I find that the actual, if you go outside and look at mud, especially after it's rained or just in general, there's normally a lot of different textures to mud. Now, this is going to be ground that's been trampled on, walked on quite a lot. Obviously, we've had our Astra Militarum dig in to a defensive position, so turf would have been moved. People would have been just wandering around, going out on patrols, all sorts. So I'm bearing all that in mind and getting lots of different textures in, using lots of different washes that I've made out of different brown paints, usually starting with burnt umber and then using European dust, as you can see me dumping on top in a moment, or just here, depends where the audio syncs up to. I also use something called wet mud to get that sort of wet mud effect. I also just drop in different varnishes. I drop in a bit of gloss varnish here, a bit of matte varnish there, just so that we have some different finishes to the textures of the mud overall. And then I just dump a load of ground forming terrain on top from Geek Gaming Scenics. I tend to use two different bags. One is just I think Rural Fields, and then the other one is Grimdark, sort of Grimdark City. I can see the bag over there, I just can't be asked to walk to pick it up because I'm lazy. Yeah. and then to seal everything down, I use my PVA water and isopropyl alcohol mix, so it all seeps down and makes it rock hard. I know I'm not going to lose any of those larger bits of rubble once it's all down on the board. And that is really how I like to get my ground formations done. Lots of different types of flocks all mixed together, so it's not just one solid color. Everything's sort of piled on top and looks a lot more natural than going, right, summer grass, it's all going to be summer grass. No, I like to get lots of different textures involved, so it looks more visually pleasing as well. So now it is time to start getting everything settled in its new home. We're going to start off by getting our LEDs fitted first before we start throwing more models in, and that's going to start off with our las cannon gunner. Gonna have to secure him down, feed the wire through, and then stretch that filament across to the top of its little peg so that I can get that nice angle of it firing up before I start the placement of the most Tyranids I've ever painted in pretty much one sitting. Well, two. I don't know. It's all a blur. But super gluing it all down, making sure that everything's sitting in there nice and tight before we get on to actually wiring everything up. I just want to make sure that it's in there solidly and give the glue some time to dry. Once everything's glued down and I'm happy with its placement, it's time to get on to the soldering and make sure that the wires are nice and neat. Now, I am also adding on some heat shrink, which is something that I'm new to using. So a couple of mistakes were made where I've sort of heated up the wire a bit too much and the heat shrink has, well, shrank. So I've had to remove it and then it was a bit of a faff. I'll know for next time or where and where not to place it. This is mostly so that I can make everything nice and neat afterwards and hide my wires away so they're not going to get caught or snag on anything where I put the model down. And talking about making things nice and neat, I've hidden my on-off button underneath this very unsuspecting ammo can, which I've painted up to look like a 75 round or 75 caliber bolt round, you know, for when the Space Marines one or maybe two mags of 10 to 20 rounds runs out and, you know, they're in one of these immense firefights where's all their ammo coming from? Anyway, that's another discussion for another day. I'm sure we've all got comments on that. And then we get to the part where it all really starts coming together. This is my favorite part of the build, cleaning up the edges and adding the rest of the models. This is where our story starts to be told, really starts to be told. And it is the fundamental part any diorama, personally, is what I believe. This is where your storytelling just comes to absolute life. I tried not to add too many things into this diorama. There was lots of ideas that I had that didn't quite make the final cut. I was going to have a mortar round exploding in the Tyranids and realized that's just going to be too much. The Space Marine down in the middle, again, that was going to be too much. So I've got our mortar team and their las cannon on defense, and we've got some forward observers or maybe a foot patrol that had been out earlier that is now being chased down by an absolute avalanche of Tyranids. I've put two skeletons around where some rippers are. I've got this guy here, this Cadian. He's not firing his mortar anymore. They're too close. He's just going to reach for his spade as any self-identifying Kriegsman would and go to town. You've got our guys, our forward observers, our patrol, whoever they were, desperately, desperately trying to get back to friendly lines, to get to any form of potential salvation, to not end up like their comrades, like the rest of their team, just corpses covered in green bile, biomass to feed the great devourer on the fourth Tyranid War. Thank you guys so much for joining me on yet another hobby adventure. Please like, share, subscribe if you've enjoyed my content, and I will see you in the next one.